हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू शिव ज्योति एजुकेशनल ग्रुप कोटा। हाउ आर यू स्टूडेंट्स? दिस इज़ बरखा गौर, योर बायोलॉजी टीचर। आई होप यू आर फाइन। इन दिस वीडियो आई एम गोइंग टू स्टार्ट चैप्टर 2, सेक्सुअल रिप्रोडक्शन इन फ्लावरिंग प्लांट्स ऑफ क्लास 12। चिल्ड्रन, आई होप यू हैव गॉन थ्रू द चैप्टर 1 एंड यू अंडरस्टूड वेल। इन दिस चैप्टर वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न अबाउट फ्लावरिंग प्लांट्स। In this, we will learn what is flower, what is the structure of flower, what are the different parts of flower which takes place in reproduction. Students, everybody of us are familiar with flower, and I think everybody would love flower also. When we see flower, our heart gets delighted because flowers are such beautiful thing on the earth. When we see the myriads of flower, we enjoy gazing at them. We like their scents, their perfumes, and their colors also attract us. Not only humans, but also birds, insects, they get also attracted. Actually, flowers are not made only for their beauty. They have a special purpose, that is reproduction. Flower actually helps in the reproduction, and they help in the continuity of the species of those plants. So flower are the main parts which are meant for sexual reproduction. So in this chapter we are going to learn this thing only, that is sexual reproduction in flowering plants. We know that when the plant starts flowering, it means that it is going to produce fruit also, and in the fruit seeds are also formed. So we can say that flower are the sexual reproductive part of angiosperms, which is called as flower. In flower, the male and female reproductive structures are also there, the androecium and the gynoecium. Androecium are the male reproductive part and gynoecium are the female reproductive part. So these are the two main parts which help in the reproduction. You would recollect that androecium consists of whorls of stamens. Actually, androecium contains stamens and gynoecium contains female reproductive part, that is pistil. So before we proceed, we would like to have a brief look on the parts of flower. And before that, we'll see pre-fertilization events. Actually, fertilization is what? Fusion of gametes. But before this, as we have seen in the previous chapter, that pre-fertilization event takes place first. So in this pre-fertilization event, several hormonal and structural changes results in the development of a flower. So before flower appears on the plant, some changes occurs in the plant due to which flower appears. Inflorescence, you are familiar with this term. In 11th class we have learned what is inflorescence, that is arrangement of flowers on the plant. So inflorescence, these are the flower buds and then the flowers. So we can say that flowers are the reproductive parts of a plant. In the flowers, the androecium, that is male reproductive part, and gynoecium, that is female reproductive part, develops. So we'll see one by one. First we'll understand what is androecium and how male gametes forms in them. Then we'll see gynoecium and how female gametes will form in them. So let us proceed with androecium. Children, you are familiar with this term, androecium. Androecium, we can say that group of stamens. Stamens are the male reproductive part. The one by one we'll see in detail. Actually, androecium consists of whorls of stamens, means a bunch of stamen constitute androecium. Then what is stamen? Stamen consists of filament, a long and slender stalk, and then anther. You can see in this picture, anther and filament. This is what? Stamen. So stamen consists of two parts, a long slender stalk, which is called filament, and the terminal generally lobed structure, bilobed structure, called the anther. Filament is attached to the thalamus or to the petal. Now let us move into the anther, because pollen grains are going to form in anther only. a typical angiosperm anther is bilobed. Bilobed means there are two lobes and each lobe have two theca. So it is called bilobed and dithecous. Children, generally this question is asked why a typical angiosperm is dithecous. So answer will be because it is bilobed and each lobe is dithecous. Okay. Now, theca are separated by a longitudinal groove running lengthwise. The microsporangia are located at the corners, two in each theca. They further develop to form pollen sacs which contain the pollen grain. So you can see in the diagram, you can see a longitudinal groove running lengthwise separating the two theca. The anther is a four-sided tetragonal structure consisting of four microsporangia located at the corners in each lobe. So you can see in the diagram that there are pollen sacs in which pollens are produced and some vertical lines are coming which are called line of dehiscence. It means when the anther burst, the anther burst from these lines and pollens are dispersed. The microsporangia develop further and become pollen sac. The microsporangia will develop and pollen sac will be formed. They extend longitudinally all through the length of an anther and are packed with pollen grains. Now children, we'll understand the structure of microsporangium. Okay, when we are going into the anther, inside anther, pollen sacs are there in which microsporangium are produced. Now let us understand the structure of microsporangium. Children, in a transverse section, if we cut it transversely, a typical microsporangium appears nearly circular. You can see in the diagram, it is nearly circular in outline. It is generally surrounded by four wall layers. Look at the picture carefully. Four wall layers are there. What are these four wall layers? The epidermis, you know, we are starting from the outside. The epidermis, then second is endothecium, then middle layer and tapetum. Tapetum is the innermost. The outer three wall layers, you know, what's the function of outer three wall layer? They perform the function of protection and help in dehiscence of anther to release the pollens. Okay, now the most important, the innermost wall layer is called tapetum and its function is very important. Learn this properly. It nourishes the developing pollen grains. Means tapetum nourishes, means provide nutrition to the developing pollen grains. Cells of the tapetum possess dense cytoplasm and generally have more than one nucleus. Okay. So this is the structure of microsporangium. So you should go through it properly and practice for this diagram also. Now microsporogenesis. What is the microsporogenesis? Microsporogenesis means the formation of, the process of formation of microspore from pollen mother cells. Now let us understand it in the detail. When the anther is young, a group of compactly arranged homogeneous cells called sporogenous tissue occupies the center of each microsporangium. In the diagram, in the previous slide, we saw that at the center there is a tissue called sporogenous tissue. Now in the process of microsporogenesis, what happens? As the development occurs in the anther, the sporogenous tissue undergo meiosis. All of you are familiar with the meiosis term, I think. So it undergoes meiosis to form four microspore tetrads. How many microspore tetrads? They form microspore tetrad. Tetrad means four cells. Now, each cell of sporogenous tissue has capacity to give rise to a tetrad. So as each cell of sporogenous tissue is capable of giving rise to a microspore tetrad, each one is a potential pollen or microspore mother cell. The process of formation of microspore from a pollen mother cell through meiosis is called microsporogenesis. The microspores, as they are formed, are arranged in a cluster of four cells. That's why they are called microspore tetrad. As the anther matures, the microspore get detached from the each other and develop into pollen grains. So now pollen grains are also formed. Now we'll see the structure of pollen grain. You all must have seen any flower. If we dust that flower on our hand or on the paper, we see some dust like structure. Suppose you are taking China rose, you will find some yellowish powdery structure, powdery structure on the paper. So what are those? These are pollen grains. And when we observe it under the microscope, so how it looks, that we'll see in this part. The pollen grains, they represent the male gametophyte. They have a two-layered wall. Each pollen grain are spherical and they have a two-layered wall. It is very interesting. Try to understand. Now the outer wall is called exine and the inner wall is called intine. Actually, pollen grains are spherical, measuring about 25 to 50 micrometers in diameter. It has a prominent two-layered wall, the hard outer layer called the exine. Please pay attention to this. This is important. The hard outer layer called the exine is made up of sporopollenin. Remember this word, sporopollenin, which is one of the most resistant organic material known. It can withstand high temperature and strong acids and alkali. So hard it is. No enzyme that degrades sporopollenin is so far known. Pollen grain exine has prominent apertures called germ pores, where sporopollenin is absent. So although the exine is very hard, made up of sporopollenin, but there are some pores, some small holes are present where sporopollenin is absent. So that, why it is absent? When the pollen tube will arise, it will come out through these pores. The pollen grains are well preserved as fossils because of the presence of these sporopollenin. So they can be preserved for a long period of time. The exine exhibits a fascinating array of pattern and designs in various species. Now let us see the second layer, that is intine, which is inner layer. The inner wall of pollen grain is called the intine. It is a thin and continuous layer made up of cellulose and pectin. The cytoplasm of pollen grain is surrounded by a plasma membrane as usual. When the pollen grain is mature, it contains two cells, vegetative cells and generative cell. The vegetative cell, we can compare both these cells. You can look at the diagram also. The vegetative cell is bigger. It has abundant food reserve and a large irregularly shaped nucleus. So which is the bigger cell? Vegetative cell. Second is the generative cell, which is small and floats in the cytoplasm of the vegetative cell. So generative cell is the small cell. Children, in over 60% of angiosperms, pollen grains are shed at this two-cell stage. So generally, 60% of angiosperms shed their pollen grains at this two-celled stage. In the remaining species, the generative cell divides mitotically to give rise to two male gametes before pollen grains are shed. That is, they are shedding their pollen grain at three-celled stage. Pollen grains of many species cause severe allergies. Sometimes if you smell the flower, if you smell any flower, some of you may find that you start sneezing. So why it is? Due to the pollens. So they may cause severe allergies and bronchial infections in some people, leading to chronic respiratory disorders like asthma and bronchitis. So for some people it may be allergic. It may be mentioned that Parthenium or carrot grass that came into India as a contaminant with imported wheat has become एबिकविशस इन ऑकरेंस एंड कॉज पॉलन एलर्जी. तो पॉलन्स ऑफ पार्थेनियम ऑल्सो कॉज एलर्जी. नाउ चिल्ड्रन, यू मस्ट बी फैमिलियर और मे नॉट बी फैमिलियर विद दिस, दैट पॉलन ग्रेन्स आर रिच इन न्यूट्रियंट्स. द पॉलन ग्रेन्स आर रिच इन न्यूट्रियंट्स ऑल्सो. इट हैज़ बिकम अ फैशन इन रिसेंट ईयर्स टू यूज पॉलन टैबलेट्स एज फूड सप्लीमेंट्स. तो दिस इज़ न्यू फॉर यू दैट पॉलन्स कैन बी यूज एज फूड सप्लीमेंट्स. इन वेस्टर्न कंट्रीज अ लार्ज नंबर ऑफ पॉलन प्रोडक्ट्स इन द फॉर्म ऑफ टैबलेट्स एंड सिरप्स आर अवेलेबल इन द मार्केट. Pollen consumption has been claimed to increase the performance of athletes and race horses. Children, pollen grains can be stored also. But viability of these pollen grains, different pollen grains may have different viability. When once they are shed, pollen grains have to land on the stigma. Otherwise, they may lose their viability. Means they will die. If they are not fertilized, the period for which pollen grains remain viable is highly variable, means it is different in different species. In some cereals such as rice and wheat, pollen grain lose their viability within 30 minutes. And in some members of rosaceae, leguminosae, solanaceae, they maintain viability for months. So it is variable. But pollens can be stored also in pollen banks for a long time period. Means they are stored in liquid nitrogen at about -196 degrees Celsius. So in pollen banks, pollens can also be stored. So this was about male gamete, how male gamete is formed. Now we will study about female gamete formation. Or we'll see the structure of gynoecium also and how female gametophyte is formed. Now what is gynoecium? Gynoecium represents the female gametophyte, or it is a female reproductive part of the flower. The gynoecium may consist of a single pistil also, children. It may contain one pistil, so it will be called monocarpellary. Or if it contains many pistils, it will be called multicarpellary. And if it is multicarpellary, the pistil may be fused in one, so it will be called as syncarpus. And if they are not fused together, they will be called as apocarpus. Now let us see the structure of pistil. Pistil consists of three parts: stigma, style and ovary. Stigma receives the pollen grains. Style is elongated, slender part below the stigma. And ovary is the bulged part containing placenta, which is located inside the ovarian locule. The placenta contains the megasporangia or ovules. Now, as we understood about the microsporangium, we will understand what is megasporangium. And in the megasporangium only, female gametophyte is going to be produced. The megasporangium can also be called as ovule. The diagram which you are seeing on your screen, it can be called as structure of a typical anatropous ovule also, or it can be called as megasporangium or structure of a typical anatropous ovule. This diagram is very, very important. Now let us understand its structure. The ovule is a small structure attached to the placenta by means of a stalk called funicle. With the help of diagram, try to understand, children. The ovule is attached to the placenta by funicle. All of you must have seen the pod of pea, mutter, in which the seeds of pea are attached. So with that you can relate this structure. The junction of ovule and the funicle is called hilum. Thus, hilum represents the junction between ovule and funicle. Each ovule has one or two protective envelopes called integuments. With the help of diagram, you can see there are two layers of integuments, outer and inner. Integuments encircle the ovule except at the tip where a small opening called micropyle is organized. You can see that at the place of micropyle the integuments are absent. Opposite the micropylar end is the chalaza representing the basal part of the ovule. The one end is micropylar end, another is chalazal end. Enclosed within the integuments, if we move inner to the integuments, there is a mass of cells called nucellus. You can see in the diagram, nucellus is there. Cells of the nucellus have abundant reserve food material. Located in the nucellus is the embryo sac. Inner to the nucellus is embryo sac or female gametophyte. So here female gametophyte is going to be formed. An ovule generally has a single embryo sac formed from a megaspore through reduction division. So this was the structure of megasporangium. This is very important, children. Now we'll understand how female gametophyte is formed. The formation of female gametophyte is called megasporogenesis. The process of formation of megaspores from the megaspore mother cell is called megasporogenesis. Ovules generally differentiate a single megaspore mother cell, that is MMC, in the micropylar region of the nucellus. It is a large cell containing dense cytoplasm and prominent nucleus. The MMC, let us understand this whole process by this diagram. The MMC undergoes meiotic division. Now let us go through this diagram and understand the structure properly and understand the process of megasporogenesis. In a majority of flowering plants, one of the megaspore is functional while the other three degenerate. So when the meiosis occurred, four megaspore mother cells are formed. Okay, four megaspore mother cells are formed, and out of those four, the three will degenerate and only one is functional. So only one functional megaspore develops into female gametophyte embryo sac. This method of embryo sac formation from a single megaspore is termed as monosporic development. Listen carefully, children. As only one cell is functional and other cells are degenerating, that's why this kind of development is called monosporic development. You can see the second point of female gametophyte, the single functional megaspore develops into the female gametophyte. This kind of development is called monosporic development. Now look at the diagram once again to understand the whole process. Let us study formation of embryo sac in detail. The nucleus of functional megaspore divides mitotically. See first diagram, only one cell is there. This is what? Functional megaspore. This is one of the functional megaspore. So the nucleus of functional megaspore divides mitotically to form two nuclei. You can see in the second picture, two nuclei are formed which move to the opposite poles. Okay, these two nuclei will move to the opposite cells, forming the two nucleate embryo sac. So the second picture is two nucleate embryo sac. Two more sequential mitotic nuclear divisions results in the formation of four nucleate. So you can see in the third picture, four nucleate condition is there, and later eight nucleate stages of the embryo sac. You can see in the lower line, first of all two cells are there, then four, then eight. So at the end, eight nucleate stage is reached. It is of interest to note that, children, these mitotic divisions are strictly free nuclear. That is, nuclear divisions are not followed by cell wall formation. You can see only free nucleus are there. Now after the eight nucleate stage, cell walls are let down. Now cell wall will form, leading to the organization of typical female gametophyte or embryo sac. Okay, now female gametophyte will form. You can see the distribution of cells inside the embryo sac in through this diagram. Now see the picture B part. What is in this? 6 of the 8 nuclei are surrounded by cell walls. Okay, and organized into cells. The remaining 2 nuclei called polar nuclei are situated below the egg apparatus in the large central cell. So you can see in figure B that 3 cells are on the upper part, 3 cells are on the lower part. That means 3 cells are forming at the micropylar end and 3 cells are forming at the chalazal end. And 2 nuclei, you can see 2 polar nuclei in the central cell. Okay. Now there is a characteristic distribution of the cells within the embryo sac. It is very important part. 3 cells are grouped together at the micropylar end and constitute the egg apparatus. You can see on the upper part, that is on the micropylar end, 3 cells are grouped together. And what they are forming? Egg apparatus. Now listen carefully. The egg apparatus in turn consists of 2 synergids. You can see in the diagram, 2 synergids, and one is what? One is egg cell. Okay. The synergids have special cellular thickenings at the end, at the micropylar tip, called filiform apparatus. In the last picture you can see it is inverted now. The micropylar is end, micropylar end is on the lower part. You can see there is filiform apparatus. Thickening is there, which is called as filiform apparatus. This also has a very important function in guiding the pollen tube into the synergid. When the pollen tube will be coming, so this filiform apparatus will guide the pollen tube to enter into the female gametophyte. Now 3 cells are at the chalazal end. You can see on the top chalazal end, these cells are called antipodal. So these 3 cells are called antipodal cells at the chalazal end. The large central cell, as mentioned earlier, has 2 polar nuclei in the center. 2 polar nuclei in the central cell. Now children, you can understand clearly that a typical angiosperm embryo sac. Now at this stage, this embryo sac has 8 nucleus. You can count 8 nucleus. But the cells are how many? Yes, 7 cells are there and 8 nucleus are there. Why not 8 cells? Because the 2 central cells are not separated by cell wall. So it is 8 nucleate and 7 celled stage. Children, this whole process of megasporogenesis is very important from board point of view. Please go through it properly. Now, as we have seen, gametes are formed. When gametes are formed, then the next step is that these gametes have to be transferred. We have seen male and female gametes are formed. But now both the gametes are non-motile. They cannot move by themselves. So they have to be brought together for fertilization. Now how this is achieved? How it can be achieved? So there is a process called pollination to bring them together. So it is the process of transfer of pollen grains from the anther to the stigma. This is called pollination. You are familiar with this term. But now in detail we'll understand how many types of pollination may occur. I know that you have already learned about self-pollination and cross-pollination, but a little bit more detail, in more detail we'll understand, and we'll be introducing some new terms. So let us see what are those new terms. So kinds of pollination may, first of all we'll learn what is autogamy. Autogamy, actually it in this type pollination is achieved within the same flower. It is a kind of self-pollination only. So within the same flower, transfer of pollen grains from the anther to the stigma of the same flower is called what? Autogamy. It requires the anther and the stigma to lie close. then only it can occur. It also requires synchrony in the pollen release and stigma receptivity. Now, what is this synchrony? Synchrony means both pollen and stigma should become mature or should release together. Then only this autogamy can occur. Children, now some plants such as viola, oxalis and camelina produce two types of flowers. How? Let us see. First is chasmogamous flowers. Chasmogamous flowers, which are similar to flowers of other species with exposed anthers and stigma. As we see, many flowers have exposed anthers and stigma, as in China rose. So these are similar to those. So they are called chasmogamous. But another type of flower are clistogamous. Flowers which do not open at all. Remember this term, the flowers which do not open at all. In such flowers, the anthers and stigma lie close to each other. When anthers dehisce in the flower buds, means they remain in the bud form only, they do not open. So when anthers dehisce, means they burst in flower buds, pollen grains come in contact with the stigma to effect pollination. Thus, clistogamous flowers are invariably autogamous. So only autogamy, means only self-pollination, can occur in these flowers. So there is no chance of cross-pollination. Clistogamous flowers produce assured seed set even in the absence of pollinators. It does not require any pollinator because flower will not open. If flower will not open, so no need of pollinators. And it is sure that seed will formed. Okay, so these are the special flowers which are known as clistogamous. Next is gitonogamy. Gitonogamy, it is the transfer of pollens from the anther of one flower to the stigma of another flower. But the condition is the plant should be same. The plant will be same, only flowers will be different. Genetically, they are similar because the plant is one only. But it requires pollinating agents like wind, insects or any. And last is xenogamy. In this, it is the transfer of pollen grains from the anther to the stigma of a different plant. Plant will be different, so automatically flower will also be different. Pollination causes genetically different types of pollens to be brought to a plant. In this, the seed produced will be genetically dissimilar from its parents. Now we'll see, we have seen the kinds of pollination. Now we'll see agents of pollination, means the agents which will help in pollination. Although we are familiar, like pollination can be brought about by wind, by birds, by insects, by animals, by water, etc. So let us see one by one. Pollination by wind. Actually, pollination can be brought about by abiotic and biotic factors both. So abiotic mein generally wind and water, and biotic means animals. So majority of plants use biotic agents. Only a small proportion of plants use abiotic agents. Pollen grains coming in contact with the stigma is a chance factor in both wind and water. So it's a factor of chance. So to compensate this, the flowers produce enormous amount of pollens when compared to the number of ovules. The ovule is safe, but pollens may be destroyed, or they may be they may fall where they cannot pollen tube cannot be arised. So they have to be produced in enormous number, means more in number. So let us see by pollination by wind. It is the most common form of abiotic pollination. Plants possess well exposed stamens and large feathery stigma. Feathery stigma so that it can fly in the air. Pollen should be light and non-sticky to be carried easily by winds. Wind pollination flowers, pollinated flowers, often have single ovule in the ovary and numerous flowers packed in an inflorescence, for example, grasses. Children, one important thing is that ye characteristics of these characteristics are important from practical point of view also. So you should learn these points properly. So these are the characteristics of pollens of wind pollination. Second is pollination by water. Water also helps in pollination. Pollination by water is quite rare in flowering plants and is limited to about only 30% and mostly monocots. Some examples of water pollinated flowers are Vallisneria and Hydrilla, which grow in fresh water, and several marine sea grasses such as Zostera. Not all aquatic plants use water for pollination. In a majority of aquatic plants such as water hyacinth and water lily, the flowers emerge above the level of water and are pollinated by insect or wind only. In Vallisneria, the female flower reaches the surface of water by long stalk, and the male flower or pollen grains are released on the surface of water. They are carried passively by water currents. Some of them reach the female flowers and the stigma. Another group, such as sea grasses, female flowers remain submerged. So some plants are such which remain submerged, and the pollen grains are released inside the water. Pollen grain in many such species have a special characteristics, means they have long ribbon like, and they are carried passively inside the water. Some of them reach the stigma and achieve pollination. To protect themselves from the water, they are protected by a mucilaginous covering. They have a mucilaginous covering which helps in protection. Otherwise, they will get destroyed. Pollination by animals. This is very common. The majority of flowering plants use butterflies, bees, wasps, etc. for pollination. Most of the insect pollinated flowers are large, colorful, fragrant, and contain nectar to attract the animal pollinators. These are called floral rewards. That means when the insects are coming to the flower to take the nectar, in turn they are helping in pollination. The floral reward can be in the form of providing safe places to lay eggs. Sometimes these insects lay eggs, for example Amorphophallus. And a very interesting example, that a symbiotic relationship exists between the plant yucca and its pollinator moth. What happens in them? The moth is dependent on the plant, since the moth deposits its eggs in the locule of the ovary of the plant. Means they lay in the ovary only, and in turn the plant is pollinated by the moth. So it's interesting. The pollen grains are sticky and get stuck to the body of the pollinator. So we saw in nature also there is a mutual relationship between these insects and plants. So they both are benefiting each other. So children, in this video we have gone through how the gametes are formed, how they can reach to each other with the help of pollination. In the next video we'll go through with outbreeding device, pollen pistil interaction, and formation of fruit and seed. Students, I hope you understood this video. Take care. Goodbye.